It's time for questions and minister statements, and I'll call Ms Crozier with a question, please.
Thank you, President. My question is to the Minister for Disability. Minister, on the 9th of November, a comment was made on the Australian Jewish Association Facebook page in response to a Holocaust survivor that read, and I quote, "How unfortunate you survived. We need Hitler around to gas you all," end quote. The author of this comment appears to be a registered disability worker in Victoria. Minister, can you commit to conducting an inquiry into this highly disturbing issue? Because if accurate, this is certainly not the person we would want dealing with our most vulnerable in the community.
Minister.
Thank you, President, and thank you, Ms Crozier, for your question. Certainly any behaviour or commentary of that nature would be highly concerning, and I take on board your question and will make further investigations.
Ms Crozier, supplementary.
Thank you, President, and Minister, thank you for your response. Minister, given the Disability Worker Registration Board of Victoria is responsible for assessing suitability for registration of disability workers, including that they meet set standards for registration, will you also refer this matter to the Disability Worker Registration Board for its assessment?
Minister.
Thank you, President, and thank you, Ms Crozier, again for your question. Obviously, the disability services landscape in Victoria is quite complex, and we have National Disability Insurance Scheme services and Victorian services, and also the worker registration aspects of the Victorian aspects of those services. I'll undertake, as I said, the investigation, and where relevant, I'll then take appropriate steps.
The member that's allocated the second question isn't here, so we'll move to the minister's statement, and I'll call Minister Shing.
Thank you, President. It's always a pleasure to be able to rise to provide an update on the progress being made toward our commitments as they relate to water. And last week I joined my colleagues in the other place, the wonderful members for Northcote, Preston, Pascoe Vale, Broadmeadows and Thomastown by the beautiful and on that day rather noisy Merri Creek to open the first round of our GreenLinks grants. This is a $10 million grants fund, and it's a really important component part of our protecting waterways so our wildlife can thrive election commitment. And working closely with our local communities, this program is about greening up to 200 hectares of land across our catchments in Melbourne and down to Geelong. So in this first year, $6 million of grant funding is available to community groups. Like our friends groups, and the Friends of Merri Creek was there last week, traditional owners, local government, water corporations and our catchment management authorities to support their projects. There are two streams of grants, excuse the pun, local projects of between $20,000 and $200,000, and then catchment-sized projects of between $200,000 and $2 million. So that should please you, Mr. McGowan, burbling like a stream as you are on the opposite side of the chamber. So in year one, grants.
Ms. Watt, point of order.
The minister is making a minister's statement on an issue very important to the people of the Northern Metropolitan Region. I'm having a lot of trouble hearing at this end of the chamber. If I could get you to direct those interrupting to stop it, thanks.
I uphold the point of order. I could hear the minister, and I don't think she was being that provocative to provoke interjections. And seeing we didn't have the second question, can I get the clock reset and the minister can start again without any noise?
Take two.
Oh, well, maybe you'll think twice.
What a wonderful opportunity here today to provide a really significant update to the House about the Greenlinks Fund, which is a $10 million fund that should lead to no end of excitement for Coalition colleagues on the other side of the chamber. This is a fund which is a key component of our Protecting Waterways So Our Wildlife Can Thrive commitment. And we're working alongside communities and it's a program that aims to deliver 200 hectares of land greening across our really important catchments in Melbourne and Geelong. So in this first year of funding, there'll be $6 million in grants funding available to community groups, and it was a joy to join my wonderful colleagues in the other place, the members for Northcote, Preston, Pascoe Vale, Broadmeadows and Thomastown, to make this announcement. Friends groups, traditional owners, local government, water corporations and our catchment management authorities. This is about an initial allocation of $6 million to two streams of grants, local projects of between $20,000 and $200,000. And catchment scale projects of between $200,000 and $2 million. In year one, the first round of grants will be available to Edgars Creek, Darabin Creek, Gardner's Creek, Jackson's Creek, Coonung Creek, Corroit Creek, the Maribyrnong River, Cherry Creek, Merry Creek, Mooney Ponds Creek, Steel Creek, and Stony Creek, as well as waterways within the Yarra Strategic Plan, Waterways of the West, and Rivers of the Barwon Action Plan catchments. Our urban waterways are so important to livability, to biodiversity, and to managing the increasing impacts of climate change. I can't wait to see these projects delivered and applications flow as a priority.
Ms. Broad with a question, please.
Thank you. My question is to the Minister for Housing. A woman in Echuca who was fleeing domestic violence and needed urgent access to public housing was told that the best the state could offer her is a tent at a local caravan park for 6 months. Why is the government failing vulnerable women?
Minister.
Thank you. Thank you for that question. Family violence has been a key driver for vulnerability, risk and need across so many parts of our system. And we know that when we address the challenges of family violence as they arise, predominantly for women and children, we need to be able to provide people with somewhere that is safe and somewhere that has access to the appropriate level of support. This is about so much more than bricks and mortar and providing a roof over people's heads. Ms. Broad, I'm really keen to hear more about this particular matter that you've raised about this person in Echuca. I would very much like to talk about what can be done and what the situation was. In the 2022-2023 year, almost one in five, so that was 859 households, experiencing family violence were allocated to public housing. That's more than at any other time in the last 6 years. We also know that family violence is a key driver of demand for homelessness support services, and that we've seen an increase of 50% of support in homelessness assistance for people experiencing family violence since 2012-2013. And there are a few factors that have led to this. We've seen a range of pressures on our systems, not just here in Victoria, but around Australia. And we know that the average waiting time reflects strong demand for social housing. Budget Paper 3 targets have shown us we've got a lot of work to continue to do, and that's exactly what we are doing. There has been an allocation in the 22-23 budget of $69.1 million over 4 years to fund existing family violence refuges, to build and staff two new core and cluster refuges, to upgrade three existing partner agency operated facilities, and also to purchase six new crisis accommodation properties. There's been $40.4 million also invested in a range of targeted housing support to transform and meet that critical demand. when we do have a notification of family violence, triage occurs in relation to risk and vulnerability, and where housing is not able to be found in immediately across the social housing stock, then alternative accommodation is arranged so that people do have what they need in the short term, and that's where the crisis accommodation comes in. I'll look into that matter if you can provide me with some further detail and we can go from there.
Ms. Broadwood, supplementary?
Yeah, thank you, Minister, for your response and for your willingness to learn more about it. I guess as far as alternative accommodation goes, hopefully we can do better than a tent. Public housing wait times for women fleeing domestic violence have tripled to 2 years under this government. How many vulnerable Victorian women and their children are at risk because this government has failed to provide them with public housing?
Minister.
Are at risk. Thank you, Ms. Broad. I don't know whether you're seeking an opinion from me as to who may be at risk or may be vulnerable. We have committed to a record investment for social housing, for homelessness supports, and also for making sure that as part of the big housing build, we're providing housing to people, including victims and survivors of family violence. The big housing build will provide 1,000 homes across that overall investment for people who are victims and survivors of family violence. And it's also about making sure that we are providing people with the broader supports that they need. Again, as I said in the answer to my first question, this is a really an issue that goes far beyond bricks and mortar. And again, very happy to continue to work with you on the first issue you've raised.
Dr. Mansfield with a question, please.
Thank you, President. My question is for the Minister for Water. The Commonwealth is likely to scrap the socioeconomic neutrality test for the Murray-Darling Basin Plan based on a growing body of evidence and expert opinion that it is fundamentally flawed. Will the Victorian government continue to use the socioeconomic neutrality test as the basis for its water policy?
Minister.
Thanks, President. Thank you for this question. And I'm really keen to make sure that in answering this question, I can address a range of positions that have been put about the data and the research that Victoria has relied upon. Not only have we looked to the Murray-Darling Basin Authority's report card, but we've also got the Frontier Economics report. We have a range of reports from ABARES. We also have work on the ground in communities. Communities and people I've been speaking with for years now about the impact of those 550 gigalitre buybacks that occurred. The socioeconomic criteria, to be absolutely clear, were agreed to by every basin jurisdiction. The reason that they are in legislation is that in 2018, socioeconomic criteria were introduced that confirmed that the return of any water to the environment, in addition to the component parts of the 2,750 gigalitre commitment as part of the Murray-Darling Basin Plan legislation in 2012, would only be capable of taking place where there are positive or neutral socioeconomic outcomes. This means that we cannot harm communities under the current legislation as it applies. But let's also be clear. Victoria has contributed the greatest volume of water returned to the environment out of any jurisdictional party to the Murray-Darling Basin Plan. We continue to develop and to deliver initiatives grounded in hundreds of thousands of hours of work.
Dr. Mansfield, point of order.
Point of order. The Minister's not answering the question. Just bring it back to the question on relevance. I asked, will the Victorian Government continue to use the socioeconomic neutrality test?
I think the Minister was responsive to the question, Minister.
Thank you. And again, this is what happens when we hear parts of this debate on natural resource management and water policy, a really complex part of what we do around a basin that goes well beyond any state's jurisdiction. As soon as there is a context and research that doesn't fit with a narrative, this debate is shut down. We stand by the application of the socio-economic criteria. Buybacks harm communities. Buybacks do not achieve the outcomes for Victorian environments that others are seeking to apply across different parts of the basin. And again, to be really clear, the northern part of the basin, those iconic images of the Darling in crisis, will not be assisted one bit by buybacks from Victoria. We cannot move the water to the Darling where it is needed. That must come from the northern basin.
Dr. Mansfield, with supplementary.
Thank you, President, and I thank the Minister for her response. Sounds like the Victorian Government will continue to use the socioeconomic neutrality test, despite the Commonwealth and the other basin states looking like they're going to move away from that. The flawed nature of this test was a finding of the South Australian Murray-Darling Basin Royal Commission. It's been argued that it's flawed by four economics professors from four leading Australian universities, and it's been recommended, and it's been in separate studies, and it has been recommended in a recent Senate inquiry. Minister, are you questioning the credibility of these economists, the Royal Commission, and the Senate inquiry findings?
Minister.
Thank you, Dr. Mansfield. The literature review, the Wentworth review that you've just talked to, and the University of Adelaide academic review is in stark contrast to the lived experience of communities who rely upon the Murray to produce food and to make sure that their communities can thrive. We saw communities disappear off the map. We saw job losses in Redcliffs of 76% as a consequence of this 550 gigalitre buyback situation that we endured and were able to deliver water to the environment on. When we talk about research, again, it seems that wherever anybody finds research that disagrees with a thesis on the impact of buybacks, it is derided. We know from experience that buybacks harm communities. When you talk about socioeconomic neutrality, it then means that any change to that agrees that there will be harm to communities. We do not accept that for a moment, and we do not sign on to any change to socioeconomic criteria.
Minister Erdogan, Minister's statement, please.
Thank you, President. On Tuesday, I had the opportunity to highlight Fruit to Work were providing employment opportunity to those exiting custody. Today, I want to acknowledge a number of other fantastic Victorian employees that are providing meaningful opportunities for people leaving prison. We know how important having a job is in preventing reoffending, helping people turn their lives around, and making us all safer in our communities. That's why Corrections Victoria has fostered relationships with a range of employees across the state who are providing employment opportunities for people leaving custody. Thanks to the government's investment in the Prison Employment Program, along with our investment in TAFE, ably led by Minister Tini, and vocational programs in prison, employers are lining up to provide opportunities to people leaving prison. Just a few organisations that have worked closely with us and I wish to recognise today include Chandler McLeod, a national employment agency, but in particular their team in Northern Victoria in Shepparton. QA Steel Fixing, who are working closely with Jesuit Social Services to support people into employment in our construction sector. Second Chance Labour, a brilliant community organisation placing people in employment across our state. Yambuk Labour Solutions, providing employment opportunities for Aboriginal people, predominantly around Ballarat and Geelong areas. And of course, Fruit to Work, who are based in Laverton North and expanding into our southeast suburbs. Partnerships like these across the community are a vital part of our strategy to successfully transition people from custody back into the community in a way that makes us all safer.
Mr. Mulholland with a question, please.
My question is to the Minister for Housing. Minister, in response to evidence yesterday that Victoria's public housing stock had increased by just 394 properties since 2018, the Premier conceded that there have been some challenges in meeting the government's promise to build 12,000 social and affordable homes by next year and blamed consecutive interest rate rises and supply chain disruptions. The Premier said that 7,600 social and affordable homes have been built or are under construction. However, you said just 3,000 social homes have been completed, with another 4,600 under construction or in planning. Minister, seeing as there is some confusion between the two of you, who is right, you or the Premier?
Minister.
Oh, Mr. Mulholland. Again, your interest in social housing, it is somewhat confounding but rather delightful. As part of the investment in the big housing build, that commitment to 12,000 social homes across the state is added to by an additional minimum 1,300 additional homes as part of the rural and regional big housing build, and that adds to the minimum spend of $1.25 billion for regional Victoria. In developing and delivering these homes as part of this landmark investment that is leading the nation, we have 7,600 homes, social homes, either complete or in the process of being completed through planning and construction. This, Mr. Mulholland, is about making sure that when and as we deliver these homes, they are modern, they are accessible, they are fit for purpose, and they are close to the amenities that everybody deserves in calling somewhere home, that is proximate to early childhood education, to primary and to secondary education, to healthcare, to public transport. Mr. Mulholland, you can slice and dice the figures in the way that you have just now. I've been very clear, as has the Premier, that of the 12,000, we have 7,600 homes as part of the work that has been undertaken to date, of which 3,000 have been completed, with the remainder either in planning or in construction. This is about at least 800 construction sites around the state. It's about 10,000 new jobs every single year. And unlike those in Canberra who for 9 years failed to invest in social housing, at last we have record investment of $497 million from the Commonwealth for at least 879 additional social homes. The Social Housing Accelerator, Mr. Mulholland, you will be delighted to know Minister Julie Collins from the Commonwealth, the Albanese government, has made sure is being put to the best use possible. And I'm looking forward, when I head to a ministerial council for housing ministers next week, also engaging with a range of other parts of housing policy reform, including homelessness and rough sleeping, and making sure that the work we do in Victoria that is informed by the housing statement, this intergenerational reform piece of delivering 80,000 homes a year for the next 10 years to meet growth in demand, has a significant focus on social housing and delivers, again, those reforms that matter far beyond the sorts of questions you might ask in this place to people who can then call home a beautiful new residence that is a source of pride, a source of inclusion, and means that people, families, have the opportunities that so many, too many of us in this place and beyond take for granted. They deserve the sorts of outcomes that we are funding in record amounts.
Mr. Mulholland, supplementary.
Thank you. Even if we are to believe the Premier's comments that 7,600 social and affordable homes have been built or under construction, this leaves us 4,400 homes short of what has been promised. When will they be delivered?
Minister.
Thank you, President. Thanks, Mr. Mulholland. Again, it's good to see that you're in the process of giving encouragement to the record investments we're making in social housing across the state. Every day, Mr. Mulholland, we are in the process of building and of delivering. And much as you may wish to deride that, much as you may wish to downplay that, this is about delivering homes for people who need them and who deserve them. Mr. Mulholland, just the other day, it was a joy to head out with Mr. Batchelor and a range of student leaders from Elsternwick Primary to check out the brand new homes that are coming online. Bang Street, Paran, the ground lease models 1 and 2. Every single day we are continuing to work
Mulholland, point of order.
I've asked the Minister, just on relevance, I've asked the Minister when the remaining 4,400 homes will be delivered, and I've waited patiently for that answer, and we've got 7 seconds left.
Call the Minister to the question.
Thank you, Mr. Mulholland. Every single day we're building. Every single day we are developing. We are developing homes that meet the needs of Victorians. I look forward to you coming along to see that work in real life, because it is a sight to behold.
Thank you, Minister. Ms. Purcell with a question, please.
Thank you, President. My question is for the Minister representing the Minister for Agriculture. In 2017, the government committed to modernising our animal protection laws with a brand new act, replacing the Prevention of Cruelty to Animals Act, due to be in place by 2019. However, in 2023, we are yet to see a draft bill. When will the government introduce their new Animal Care and Protection Act?
Minister.
Thank you, President, and I will certainly refer your question to the Minister for Agriculture, because I think it'll kind of be a part B to Mr. Borman's question from yesterday, so that will go well for the Minister's office.
Two sides of the same.
Ms. Purcell, with a supplementary.
Thank you, President, and thank you, Attorney, for referring that on. A key change in this new legislation is acknowledging sentience of animals. It does something we've all known for a long time, that animals can feel a range of emotions as well as experience pain and suffering. Will the legislating of sentience cover all animals, not just some of them?
Minister.
Thank you, President. As tempting it is as a former agriculture minister to go into some detail, I might leave that for the current minister, and I'm sure she'll go back to you.
Minister Blandfawn, for the Minister's statement, please.
Thank you, President. I rise to update the House on the 2023 Victorian Early Year Awards. Held last Thursday, the Victorian Early Year Awards are Victoria's most highly regarded program, recognising the many professionals who support young children and their families. These awards celebrate the very best of the work that is happening in kindergartens and early childhood settings right across Victoria. And they also shine a much-deserved spotlight on the incredible role that many professionals in the sector play. These professionals, including maternal and child health nurses, playgroup facilitators and teachers and educators in our early years settings, the work they do in long daycare centres, in kindergartens, in preschools, in playgroups, maternal and child health centres, in schools, is of immeasurable value. Congratulations to all of the finalists. They could all have been winners. Their experience and professionalism is key to our Best Start, Best Life reforms. And I'm sure that in the eyes of the young people and the young children in their care and benefiting from their teaching and service, would all say that they are all winners. President, selecting a recipient of the Minister's Award from such an impressive pool of finalists was not an easy task, and I was delighted to announce the winner of this year's award is the Northern Schools Early Years K-6 model, Northern Schools Early Years Cluster. This cluster is an example of collaboration at its best. The Northern School Early Years K-6 model gives local children stability and continuity of learning as they transition from kindergarten to school. With many of these children amongst our most vulnerable and disadvantaged, the difference this program is making in the lives of local families is immense. It was my pleasure to present the Minister's Award to the Northern Schools Early Years K-6 model, the Northern Schools Early Years Cluster. Congratulations to all of the finalists and the winners of the 2023 Victorian Early Years Awards, and I look forward to attending many more to celebrate the incredible work our community professionals are doing to support young children and their families.
Mr. Mulholland, question please.
Thank you. My question is to the Minister for Corrections. The Western Plains Correctional Facility, built at a great cost of $900 million, has no operational funding and houses no prisoners. And your department has stated in the past that it is never likely to. Minister, isn't it a fact that the air conditioning remains on in these empty cells, costing Victorian taxpayers over $300,000 per month? And if so, why is this the case?
Did you hear that, Minister? Did you hear that question? Yeah. Sorry, there was a bit of noise coming from all sides. So maybe Mr. Mulholland.
One side.
Repeat the question.
My question is to the Minister for Corrections. The Western Plains Correctional Facility, built at a great cost of $900 million, has no operational funding and houses no prisoners. And your department has stated in the past that it is never likely to. Minister, isn't it a fact that the air conditioning remains on in these empty cells, costing Victorian taxpayers over $300,000 per month? And if so, why is this the case?
Minister.
Thank you, President. I thank Mr. Mulholland for his question and his interest in our correctional facilities in our state, in this instance, the Western Plains facility. I've been up front. We make no apologies for investing in our corrections facilities in our state. This is infrastructure that is needed to future-proof our system. Because obviously with the correction system, we need to understand that the number of people in custodial settings could go up and go down. And right now, due to the hard work of a whole-of-government approach, we've seen a reduction in those in our custodial settings. And I think that's a good outcome. So we are taking the time and plan for the future of our correction system, and we'll take the planning and operations of that facility very seriously before opening it. In the meantime, in the budget papers, there is an allocation of an amount of money towards maintaining the facility and securing our investment into the future. But it will be used in the future, and that's it's an important part of our future.
Mr. Mulholland, supplementary.
Minister, while the Western Plains Correctional Facility sits empty and taxpayers continue to foot the bill, has it been used for any other purposes in the past 3 months?
Minister.
Thank you very much, President. And I thank Mr. Mulholland for his supplementary question. As I stated, the Western plays an important part of future-proofing our correction system for whatever the future holds. In relation to its use, it has been used as a training facility for onboarding new correction staff. We are still hiring, and if there's anyone watching, a career in correction is very rewarding. It can make a real difference to people's lives. It's important to have that facility because it means that our operations at other facilities are not interrupted while that important training is undertaken. Thank you.
Mr. Edishank, question please.
Thank you, President. My question is to the Attorney General, and it relates to the current prohibition on cannabis and consequential arrests among our First Nations people. The potential harms caused from encounters with the criminal justice system are well documented, and our First Nations people experience these encounters at far higher rates than non-Indigenous Australians. Figures provided by the Minister for Police bear this out, with 8,000 to 10,000 people arrested every year for simple non-commercial possession of cannabis. In this context, people identifying as being Aboriginal or Torres Strait Islander were 8 times more likely to be arrested for possession of cannabis than non-Indigenous people, and 50% less likely to receive a caution. Given the Victorian Government's stated position that prevention, diversion and early intervention are the most effective and fiscally responsible way of reducing youth crime, and given that this diversion is clearly failing, can the Attorney General explain why, in 2023, the personal possession of cannabis is still a crime? Yeah. Thank you.
Minister.
It's not me.
Thank you, Mr. Edishank, for your question. And you raise important issues, and it's certainly acknowledged from the Victorian Government, particularly Justice Ministers, about the unacceptable over-representation of Aboriginal people in our justice system. And there are a range of programs that we're all committed to in reducing that and tackling that. It was a big focus of the Yuruk Justice Commission. Myself and my colleagues regularly attend the Aboriginal Justice Forum, which is made up of a range of Aboriginal leaders from around the state, but importantly involves all of our justice agencies. So corrections are represented, police are represented, and policymakers are represented. When it comes to the crime of drug possession, that is not a matter for the Attorney General. I acknowledge why you've asked it in the way you have, but the question as framed does not fit in the responsibility of me, because I'm not responsible under the orders for the Drugs and Controlled Substance Act. But I'm more than happy to provide you with other information that is at my disposal in relation to programs that are designed to divert people away from the justice system, particularly those from our First Nations.
Mr. Edishag, supplementary?
Police and health.
Thank you, President. I think perhaps in that non-answer, the question is answered. I have nothing further.
Minister Tingey, Minister's statement.
Thank you, President. The Allan Labor government is creating jobs and growth in regional Victoria by investing in what each region does best. Supported by the regional development portfolio, the new Wodonga Logistics Precinct is strengthening the role of Wodonga as a crucial road and rail hub, capable of reaching 75% of Australia's population within 24 hours. A $7.5 million investment by our government has enabled O'Brien's Transport, a third-generation family business, to relocate. The new O'Brien's Transport depot at Wodonga Precinct is three times bigger than its former location, creating 30 jobs and bringing the 110 existing staff to the new facility. O'Brien's is also doubling its storage and warehousing capacity to connect major cities and service multinational companies at its new base in Wodonga. Our government has also supported paper and packaging company Opal's new $140 million advanced manufacturing facility, which officially opened yesterday at the Wodonga precinct. Opal's new world-class 55,000 square metre facility will create 100 new jobs and support 400 additional jobs, using the very latest in recycled cardboard technology to manufacture more sustainable packaging for a wide range of sectors. The Allan Labor government is taking an evidence-based approach, driven by regional economic development strategies for each region, to back businesses like Opal and O'Brien, cementing Wodonga as a powerhouse for national supply chains and manufacturing innovation. President, this is all part of our government's investment of more than $41 billion in regional Victoria as we continue to leverage the unique strengths of each region, President.
Thank you. That ends Minister's statements and questions.